This is a tutorial on the fundamentals of TikTok Effect House. This video is for absolute beginners to TikTok Effect House, like you've just opened up the app and you can't even say for sure that you know what you're seeing. I'm going to take this from the absolute beginning, and this is going to be a series teaching you how to sort of independently make TikTok effects of your own. So do stick around for that and let's get started. So the first thing we're going to do is create an empty project. This is because it doesn't have any of the clutter that comes with any of the templates. So we're going to come here, hit create project, and the project will start up. Right, as soon as the project opens, you're met with six windows: the hierarchy, assets, your scene, the visual scripting section, the preview, and the inspector. Alright, let's start with the assets. So this is basically where you're going to import things from your computer into TikTok Effect House. So you can do this either by dragging and dropping from your computer or hitting import. Alright, if you're following along, then just import whatever photo you'd like. I am going to, for no reason in particular, import this photo of Kakashi. As you can see, it imports itself into a little folder called textures, and if you click on the photo, you're going to be able to see it on the bottom right hand side of your screen. So everything you import is going to be put here in this section. So your 3D models, if you're doing, you know, like an AR filter, your images, just like you see here, your materials, if you're going to be using any sort of material for like a 3D model or something, you know, your makeup images for any makeup filter, everything is going to be put in that section. All right, so next up is the hierarchy. You can think of the hierarchy as like the place where you summon things. So like, do you want a photo in your effect? Summon it here. Do you want a 3D model? Summon it here. Do you want a makeup filter? Summon it here. Do you want like a hand effect? Summon it here. Alright, so there are two ways to go about doing this. You can click on this plus sign over here and select one of these objects listed over here, or you can hover your mouse around the hierarchy, right click, and add your object from there. Alright, so in this tutorial, we want the photo that we imported to show up in our preview scene, so we are going to select add object, go all the way down to 2D, and select screen image. So the screen image is automatically loaded into a container called 2D foreground effects, and it is attached to a 2D camera. If you'd like to hide the screen image without removing it completely from the scene, then you can just uncheck this box and it's going to remain hidden until you come back and like recheck the box. If you'd like to hide everything that's under foreground effects, if you have like multiple images or something like that, then you can just uncheck the box next to 2D foreground effects, and that's gonna hide everything underneath there. If you want to completely delete something from the hierarchy, then you hover over it, right click, and hit delete. Alright, so we're gonna bring the screen image back in, and then we're gonna move from the hierarchy over to this section here called the inspector. So if the hierarchy is where you summon things, then the inspector is where you sort of edit and like start making changes to the thing that you summoned. And since we have screen image selected, these are the immediate changes that we can make to screen image. If you go click on 2D camera over there, you'll see that these are the immediate changes that you can make to the 2D camera. And same with the main camera up there. If you click on that, then you'll see the name there, it says camera. Those are the immediate changes that you can make to the camera. And you might be wondering what some of these changes are. So the first one is the layer. This refers to what the 2D camera is allowed to see. So as you can see, this is on default layer over here. And if you look at the 2D camera, it can see just the default layer right now. So if I was to take the screen image and move it to layer 1, then you'll see that the 2D camera won't be able to see it anymore until we go over to the 2D camera and set it so that it's able to see things that are on layer 1 as well. Alright, I'm just gonna put everything back. So set layer one off over here, and I'm going to put the screen image back onto the default layer. Alright, and next up is the sorting order. As you can see, it's set to auto sorting. That basically means if I had like multiple screen images in the hierarchy, they were gonna be ordered in the exact same way as they are in the hierarchy. So if for some reason you have screen images that overlap each other, the one that's going to be on top is the one that's going to be on top in the hierarchy. Next up is the screen transform. So transforms normally refer to things like position, so the XY coordinates, the scale, and the rotation of the object. Okay, we're going to start off with the scale because it's bothering me. If you want to like stretch an image out or make it smaller along an axis, then you change the scale. So you can either use this little slidey thing over here, or you can hard put a number in there. I'm just going to set this to 0.5 by 0.5 because that's a size that sort of makes sense. And then next we have the rotation. That just changes the rotation, the angle that it's at. And just like the scale, you can either use the slidey thing or you can sort of hard put a number in there. Alright, so next up is the pivot. The pivot is basically this little diamondy thing that's coming in and out of the square. And basically your image rotates at the pivot point. Okay, so I'm just going to put the pivot at like a weird place over here and rotate the image. You'll see that it rotates from the pivot point, not the center, when the pivot was located at the center. I'm just going to move the pivot again to like way off and then rotate the image again. You'll see that it rotates from the pivot point. I hope that makes sense. And then if like me, you're sort of like struggling to put things back to the way they were, you can actually reset the transforms back to like the way they were in the beginning. So you just hover there by screen transform, right click and hit reset, and there you'll see it was just like it was before. I'm just going to change the scale again to 0.5 by 0.5 and we'll keep it moving. Alright, and then the position is the XY coordinates along like a Cartesian plane. So 0, 0 is located like at the center of the screen, as you can see there. So if I move things in the negative X direction, then I'm moving them to the left. If I move it in the positive X, then I'm moving it to the right. If I move things in the positive Y, then I'm moving it up. And if I move it in the negative Y, then I am moving the image down. Alright, and now we finally get to use the image that we imported all of 8 minutes ago. And you're going to do that by clicking on texture and finding your image in the drop-down. Alternatively, what you could do is just drag the image from assets, from your assets folder, and just drop it there by texture. We can also change the opacity, which is basically like how ghost you want it to look. So low opacity, ghost Kakashi, and high opacity, like fully visible Kakashi. You can also change the color. This basically just changes the color, as you can see here. You can also flip your image along the x-axis, which basically just mirrors it like that, or flip it on the y-axis, which turns it upside down like that. So the thing with using the inspector is that it's for very like hard sort of permanent changes. So if you want, you know, like your opacity to be low the whole time you use the effect, then you change it in the inspector. If you want like your image's position to be moved slightly to the left the whole time you use the effect, then you change it in the inspector. But if you want, you know, like a change that happens over time, then you'd use it in your visual scripting section. So let's do a little thing over here where we change the opacity of your image over time. So let's make the effect sort of not be visible at the beginning and then fade itself in, like increasing its opacity over time like that. So to accomplish this, we are going to head over to the visual scripting section over here, and then you are going to right click and add a node. So nodes are basically the thing that does all the changing, but don't worry, I'm going to go into like great detail about all of that in the intro to visual scripting video, so do stay tuned for that. In the meantime, in the little search bar, you're going to search transit by time, which basically means transition over time. And now we want to create a node for our opacity, so you're going to head over to the inspector. You see this little circle in front of opacity, right click it and hit set opacity. In this node that says start, you're just going to drag this little green line to where it says start in the transit by time node. So you're going to notice over here that opacity is a value between 0 and 1. So we're going to head over to our visual scripting, and here in the transit by time node, we're going to take it from 0, which is like completely invisible, to 1, which is completely visible. The duration is basically the time it's going to take to get from 0 to 1, and just put 5 so that, you know, it does this in 5 seconds. And then lastly, we're going to connect the current number that opacity is on to the value of the opacity node. And then just connect stay exec to set. And now if you turn your attention to Kakashi, you'll see him become slowly more visible over there. All right, and then now let's make him increase his opacity all the way to 1 and then take it back down to 0 again. So here in the visual scripting node, just check this little box here that says ping pong. And then let's make him do it again and again and again, because now he just does it once and calls it a day. So let's make him loop like 10 times. So come over here to where it says loop, type in the number 10, and you will see him loop 10 times over. There you go. Okay, so this is basically just a long-winded way of me trying to tell you that the inspector is for like fixed sort of hard adjustments, and then the visual scripting would be for adjustments that take place as you use your effect. Alright, so I've just turned off 2D foreground effects in the hierarchy over there so that I can show you all the different sizes and shapes and colors of people that we have at our disposal. So if you click there where it says idle person 1, you will see everyone else that we have. So we've got idle person 2, and this is basically different people doing the exact same idle pose. Idle person 3, these are really useful for, like, you know, your makeup filters if you're testing any of that. We have a whole bunch of motion ones as well, where, you know, you'd want to test out any motion that's necessary for your effect to work. So you can have your person like nod down if that's what your effect needs. You know, if, I don't know, like your effect selects something by having the person nod down, you can test it out using that. You can have them do things like dance over here. Oh my gosh, are we about to judge people's dances? Let's see. Hey. Okay, I see you doing the mom asked me to perform for the guest in the living room. Let's see you. All right, we see you. Step 2, we're getting sturdy. Right now we're just warming up. This is the warm up to getting sturdy. Let's see you. Okay, she looks like she's doing like the start of like a TikTok dance. It's like boom boom, and there we go, you know. Let's see you. Yeah, this guy's doing the me at any gathering ever. He's just, you want me to what? Dance? Okay. Love it. All right, and then in addition to like all the gestures that we have, we also have these like environments. These are for testing AR filters. So I don't know if you've seen that effect where I'm not sure if it's like a zombie or like a skeleton. It sort of climbs out of a hole and then starts doing the thriller dance. You test it out in like an environment like that. We also have a dog and a cat for the pet filters. If anyone is doing like a pet filter, you can sort of test it out on this dog and a cat, because you're getting your dog and cat to actually cooperate. Yeah. All right, and then over here we have this little thing called the scene view. This is used for one of two things. So if you have like a 3D model and you'd want to test it out in 3D space, then you could use you'd plug your 3D model in there and sort of be able to tell its distance from the camera, its like distance to the directional light over there, and that sort of thing. Another thing that it's used for is makeup filters. So I'm just going to add a little like makeup filter example over here. So if, okay, let's use the eye color. So you'd want, you know, like an example of what your eye color effect would look like on sort of different skin tones, and you have that view over here in the scene view. Since you're also going to be able to see your eye color in the preview, you'd want to use, you know, someone like Idol Person 1 or any of the Idol people or something that just makes a little more sense than the dance filter that I had there. Another thing you have access to is your camera to sort of test your effect out on yourself. So if you click on this camera over there, you will see yourself. There I am. Hi. So you can use like your front camera of your monitor or like a webcam if you have access to that. You can also test your effect out in TikTok, like with your phone, without publishing it first. So you go preview in TikTok over there. It's going to generate a QR code for you. Go into your TikTok app on your phone, scan the QR code, and you're going to be able to like test your effect over there without like publishing it first. And then lastly, you can submit your effect to TikTok. That's like when everything is said and done and you're like happy with your effect, you can submit it over to TikTok for it to become like an actual effect after approval. I do have a video sort of explaining the process of making that happen, so I'm not going to go over it here. But yeah, that is basically the fundamentals of TikTok Effect House. I do hope that you are a little less lost than you were 16 minutes ago. If you have any questions or something that you want to say, then do leave it in the comments, and I will see you in part 2.